There are two kinds of patients in this world, those who have capacity and those who lack capacity. We have so far been discussing those who have capacity. Healthcare professionals may counsel these patients to complete advanced care planning, and perhaps, depending on the situation, diligent, strategic advanced care planning. We now turn to consider patients who lack capacity and ask and try to answer the question, what can be done if these patients have reached the stage of advanced dementia but have either no or have an inadequate or ineffective living will?
Someday, when thousands of people have completed the My Way cards, we may have data that says we know what a reasonable person would want if they were in this particular state of advanced dementia. We don't know that, but we do know it for some things, like the Terry Schiavo's condition of permanent vegetative state and permanent coma. And then Maria Salieri did a vast study with over 3,000 patients who died over the age of 60, and they wanted only comfort care in almost 97% of the cases. But in the absence of data for these very difficult treatment decisions, particularly when you're talking about something as we all consider so precious as food. We love food. This is a food-craving society. You need something that's more powerful. So when you get a patient, and there are millions of them out there, who reach the advanced stage of dementia without having completed a living will, or they have one but it's not effective, here's what you can do. It's called the consensus of substituted judgment. And here's how it works. Instead of just asking one person about one treatment decision for one patient by one doctor, and you just get what you get as an answer, you have three, four, five people who each one of them goes through the 48 conditions, imagining that they were in the mind of the patient before the patient became ill. How would they fill out the cards? And then a therapist facilitates a group conference that strives to reach a consensus. Here's an example. We have the patient in the bed being fed by a semi-skilled technician, food going all over the place, but still opens the mouth, still swallows at least some of what, and is incontinent doubly, of course. You can see the diapers there. We have his wife, his son, and his daughter, and they're looking at one My Way card at a time. And they're writing down on the My Decisions table what they each decide. The consensus of substituted judgment is very likely, and I want to do more research on this, to be a more accurate way to determine what treatment decisions a person would have wanted than just asking one person, who could be biased for any number of reasons. It probably causes the surrogate decision makers much less stress because not one person is responsible for, as they say, pulling the plug on grandma. And the protocol has built in a way to resolve conflicts, that facilitative session. Here's how I end my talks with general public. Plan now, die later. Plan now, live longer. Plan now, live well. Don't wait. Plan now. But you're not a general audience, so I'm going on. Well, all right. Maybe it won't be too long. All right. If you're a clinical psychologist, social worker, nurse practitioner, or specialist, or physician assistant, or a physician, even if you're retired, and possibly physical therapist and occupational therapist, you can get a national provider identifying number and bill Medicare and get those $75 times 85% of it, if you're not a physician, per half hour. And it can be 2 or 3 half hours. And the program that I've outlined takes 8 half hours minimum to do all this diligent and strategic planning. If you're a chaplain or an MFCC, RN, clinical bioethicist, or gerontologist, you can still offer counseling to patients, but they have to pay you from their pocket, or maybe they have a better insurance company than Medicare.
There is a provision, but subject to interpretation, that CMS may accept a team approach to advanced care planning that includes registered nurses and perhaps other clinicians.
Attorneys, I'm not so sure. Particularly because the National Academy of Elder Care Attorneys and really endorsed the CMS proposal, that's the Center for Medicare and Medicaid proposal, by saying that time constraints and distractions were the core obstacle to effective clinician-patient communication. They never mentioned attorney communication. They seem to, that organization, National Academy of Elder Law Attorneys, seem to acknowledge that advanced care planning should be a clinical event by a clinician. A bit about the training program, and then I'll take your questions. You observe a counseling session by, for instance, me or another one of the senior people at Caring Advocates that goes through the My Way cards and and implements the strategies with a patient. You observe that. And you also observe a consensus of substituted judgment. As a trainee, you must also complete your own diligent strategic advanced care planning, and you must practice on someone else who may be an associate or a friend or someone else in need. And then there's all kinds of webinars that we discuss patients and the reading and the videos. And when you're ready, then we observe you doing a patient. We observe you doing consensus of substituted judgment. And you get an oral examination by a committee that includes some people who have no affiliation with you or Caring Advocates. And then you can become a Caring Advocates certified planning professional. Concluding comments. The social commitment of the physician is to sustain life and relieve suffering, but where the performance of one duty conflicts with the other, the preferences of the patient should prevail. That's a good ethical statement. Chronic traumatic encephalopathy is going to become bigger and bigger news. Sylvia, the wife of the 1992 Pro Football Hall of Famer John Mackey, described dementia in this way. Hold your breath. Listen to these words. A slow, deteriorating, ugly, caregiver-killing, degenerative, brain-destroying, tragic horror. The mission of Caring Advocates is for its clinical, legal, and pastoral healthcare professionals dedicated to helping people attain peaceful and timely transitions. Our plan now to live longer approach strives to give patients confidence that their plan will be effective so they don't have to have premature dying. Counseling provides the patients a seat at the table. You may know a patient needs counseling, but ask not how you can help one patient or request. Ask how you can help all your present and future patients. One way to do that is to become acquainted with the training program. The quickest and easiest, just read the consent form that we give to patients when they agree to counseling. Then you can get your copy of a consent form, the PDF, by just sending Caring Advocates an email and putting consent form in the subject line. We've written this form to be not only information that provides informed decision, but factually enlightening, mission-driven, and goal-inspiring. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. With the Q&A, I wanted to just take a moderator's prerogative here. It said physician aid and dying peace. I wondered if you could speak to elaborated My Way approach through the videos coalescing with this new legislation.
In Oregon, 0.3% of people use the Death with Dignity Act. In contrast, there are thousands of people who are in advanced dementia, for which the Death with Dignity Act is irrelevant, doesn't do any good. You don't need a Death with Dignity Act or an End of Life Options Act because you have voluntary refusal of food and fluid if you're alert. And if we had told Brittany Maynard, right now you have a problem with episodic amnesia after your seizures, and you get confused, you can't recognize your husband for a little while. But life, you walk in the woods with your husband and your dog. Why don't you do that for a few more months? And if your fear comes true and you no longer can make decisions because your cancer has taken away your autonomy and you have a natural dying living will, and the people who love you and care about you can take care of you and let you die when you want to die. You do not have to die now. to have a, to avoid a prolonged dying later with pain and with disability. And that's a major, major message.
The second piece that's come up, other advanced care planning paradigms out there, inclusive of polls, how would you compare, given the audience at the California Coalition and the CMA, the reception of what you are offering up now in terms of this sort of very detailed 49-point approach in comparison to some of these others, five wishes and so forth?
Two things about America. I mentioned one. We love food. The other thing is, no exception, and the other is we like it quick. We like it fast. We like it easy. This ain't quick, fast, and easy. It's diligent and strategic. It gets the job done. And that's a hard sell. Last year, I gave a seminar to the general public. You know, it's just too much to absorb. But you guys can absorb it. And then you go back and you review this and you read the material. And then you're in a position where you can be a great advisor. And you know, why am I here? Because part of me is Buddhist. And because Buddhists want to reduce suffering, and because there's more suffering for a longer time for more millions of people in the area of advanced dementia than anywhere else. So that's the greatest impact that I can have.
The third item that's come up consistently, and we've always been so receptive to feedback, and especially feedback about the My Way cards. The last iteration that I had seen was that one didn't need a whole lot of formal training to be relatively skillful and sensitive using the cards because you had developed scripts that the...
An above average motivated person can do the My Way cards on his own. And in fact, if a chaplain or a psychologist or social worker said, I want to think about becoming a caring advocate, certified planning professional, where do I start? I say, pretend you're a patient and do the cards on your own. If you get stuck, you call us. In my office, there's a woman named Linda who is a paralegal, and she knows what papers should be filled out and acknowledged by a notary and so on. Clinical stuff, come to me directly. But when you're dealing with, for example, someone who's ill, someone who has some degree of impairment of capacity, they need to be massaged along, and they can't do it on their own. The My Way cards have been translated into two or three other languages, but none of them has gotten to the 2016 version yet. They can be shown on a laptop in your office by me remotely from our office. They can also be, you can use the cards on a dining room table and spread them out. You can show them on the big screen and introduce it to several people at the same time. So they have all that flexibility.
Any ideas to offer formal certifications or trainings for folks who outside of, outside of caring advocates who might want to do this work in their clinical environments to be able to do that without calling Linda or you?
Without what?
Calling Linda or you.
My idea is that if, for instance, there's a social worker in the room who says, gee, this is just what I want to do, or a retired physician who doesn't have to deal with his office rent and office staff and malpractice insurance and billing department, says, I'll do that. Then they'll take the training, and then they'll retain their affiliation with caring advocates. So that it's impossible, like, even in several hours of training, to cover every single contingency that you can imagine out there. And that's why bioethics is so delicious a topic, because I love it. I've never seen this before. You didn't teach about this. Of course not. So what do? Well, we have to talk about it. And maybe we call in another expert from another field, or we've seen it before, and this is how you handle it. So there's always a professional relationship once you get the certification, as you maintain your relationship with caring advocates. It's legal to stop eating and drinking if you are alert and if you have capacity. It's almost as universally, but not quite, via an advanced directive. But you see, most of the time, and I've analyzed these laws, they say you must continue to offer the patient food and fluid. That's different than shoving it in their mouth. I think we're on solid ground here. As an example, North Carolina, I had a patient who I interviewed in 2007, and last year his wife brought him in the advanced stage of dementia to a VA hospice. And some expert over there said, well, we can't deprive him of food and fluid. It's going to give him tremendous internal pain in all his internal organs. Not true. So I said, bring over the CD, bring over the natural dying, live it well, have him call me, and we'll get it straightened out. So that's the other area at time when caring advocates becomes effective is when you're at the push comes to shove and you have to need to have those behaviors implemented. And so she did all that and they didn't even have to call me. When they saw all that laid out, so okay, that's what he wants, and that was that. In other words, it takes arguments and knowledge and negotiations and persuasions. And if you need it, we're here to, that's what we enjoy doing, and if it reduces suffering, that's why we do it.